the moment Kurt Hennig has been promised, that he has wanted, that he has prayed for, that he has dreamt about, is at hand. Nick Bockwinkel, the heavyweight champion of the world, 247 pounds, Kurt Hennig. Robbinsdale, Minnesota, 248 pounds for the heavyweight championship of the world. Coast to coast, border to border, shore to shore. And what a match this should be. Nick Bockwinkel resorting to some of his former ways. A handshake, but then a drop kick into the middle of the back of Kurt Hennig. Something I did not expect from the champion.
You know, Rod, you nearly had the match over right there. Bockwinkel pulling a surprise out of the hat. He's known as man of a thousand holes, man of a thousand moves. And he showed a move right there. He said to himself, and I can tell you just what he's thinking, I want to get this thing over because there's a young man out there that's threatening me right now, and it's Kurt Hennig.
And certainly youth is on the side of Kurt Hennig, but experience is on the side of the champion. But that experience factor may not be so great because Kurt Hennig has been in the AWA for several years now and improving by leaps and bounds each and every match.
And also, Roddy's and wrestling fans, Kurt Hennig has wrestled a lot of the men, the top champions and former champions who Nick Bockwinkel has wrestled. So he knows their style. He watched the matches, I'm sure. He's always standing in the background in the aisle in the back when Bockwinkel wrestled. I used to be there and watch him, and he was always scouting Bockwinkel. So that's an advantage, if any. The weight distribution, they are about even, within 8 or 9 ounces. A pound, maybe. Bockwinkel is about 2 inches shorter than his younger opponent. The age limit, that doesn't matter right now because Bockwinkel is in tremendous shape. Look at that.
Both of them are.
On the feet, together.
Fast and furious.
Well, we're going to be in for a real terrific night.
Are you ready to go 60 minutes?
Oh, I don't think it'll go that far.
Well, it's a 60-minute time limit. One fall for the championship of the world. And, of course, one of the most interested spectators of all. The millions that are watching this match right now is Larry the Axe Hennig, father of Kurt.
And I'm sure Bockwinkel's dad from up and above in heaven, and I know he went there because he was a good man. He'll be watching his son and see how he's doing, if it's possible. And I know we all wish it was and hope it is. Watch them. They latch on. That's called the referee's position. That's an arm. Bockwinkel won't let him get it. Shoves him in the rope. The referee will have to break.
The referee is Gary DeRuscia.
Becoming a live wire, too. He's a good referee.
Indeed.
Excellent.
Becoming one of the very, very heavily respected referees in professional wrestling. He gets the job done.
But what they're doing now, Rod, and wrestling fans, as you know, you've been watching wrestling probably, a lot of you, as long as I've been wrestling. But, well, the real old ones, right? But they're feeling each other out. Why should I knock myself? I feel great. But anyway.
You look great, Lord.
No, but I, what I'm talking about is they're feeling each other out now. It's a cat game right now. They're feeling each other out. Bockwinkel will work on the head for a while. He might switch to an arm, then he'll go back to the head. And always waiting for an opportunity to get that clamp on, a finishing hold, or get that 3 seconds. It's a 20th of a minute. It's not easy. 3 seconds is 1 and 2 and 3. That is 3 seconds.
And that is a side headlock that Nick Bockwinkel has on Kurt Hennig. A couple of things that we can watch for. Hard shoulder block there by the champion. Back to the side headlock and a hip toss and quickly flat on his back again is Kurt Hennig. We can look for the Bockwinkel sleeper.
Right.
We can look for the axe from Kurt Hennig. I think we'll see it all before this one is over.
I think we will. And what Bockwinkel is doing, when you apply a headlock, if you look at me closely, or you don't have to, but look at a lot of wrestlers.
Vern Gagne, for one,
okay, my age group, they've got the cauliflower ears, and we have them. And that's from the headlock, where you turn the bone of your arm. You don't just put the soft part of your arm across the ear. You put the bone, the side of the arm. That's what punishes your opponent. I'm telling you a tip now. You kids, don't use it. Don't do what I tell you these wrestlers are doing. Go to a real school. I had a letter from someone just the other day to ESPN and to the AWA. There's the time.
5 minutes going to the championship match.
Being called out in a championship match. To just finish this real quick. We can't do it. There's action going on.
Hard shoulder block. Again, a hard shoulder block. And again, the side headlock, the hip toss, and again, Curt Hennig flat on his back. Finish up.
Okay. You put the arm, well, this writer wrote in and said they were very happy that I did mention on one or two occasions or several that the youngsters do not try a lot of the punishing things they see on television, because he said that he and his brother were injured by trying to wrestle and emulate professional wrestlers. So kids, don't do it. Learn amateur wrestling, go to a good teacher, learn amateur, and then when you get a little older, then you become a professional. Okay, enough of that.
Tremendous camera work here. Our four-man camera crew of Leonard Nix, Greg Fiorito, Scott McLean, Bob Steenerson doing a tremendous job under the floor directorship of Dan Ormsby, and in the truck directing it all, as always, Mike Shields. As they roll off to the corner, and the hold is going to have to be broken.
And just to not be be a name dropper for a few of the names that Bockwinkel has met and defeated, and he's been beaten a couple of times himself. He regained the title, I think, four times in his illustrious, thank you, Rod, in his illustrious career. He's wrestled such greats as Harley Race, Dory Funk Jr., Hulk Hogan, Jumbo Shiruta of Japan, Tenryu, the famous sumo wrestler, Rick Martel, Otto Vance, Ric Flair, Billy Robinson, Mad Dog Vachon, The Crusher, Wilbur Snyder, Gene Kaniski, Vern Gagne, Buddy Rogers, Giant Baba, Curtis Ealkea, many, many, many more.
Reads so like a who's who.
I could go on for the next hour, but we want to watch the wrestlers in the ring.
And right now, Bockwinkel is tied up in a head scissors put on by Curt Hennig. I'm sure there's a lot of tactical moves going on as they try to wear each other down to set the other up for a pinfall, and a tremendous quick somersault out by Nick Bockwinkel, head scissors by Curt Hennig, and out again Bockwinkel, both men on their feet. What a tremendous match we're seeing.
Oh, it sure is. And watching the bounds and watching the breathing. You watch your opponent. You see him drawing a lot of wind. You know, maybe he parted a little bit too late a week ago. So you watch the breathing, and if you see that the abdominals start pumping, then you know that you're wearing your man down. Condition is 80% of any profession. Top condition, that is.
Side headlock again by Bockwinkel as Curt Hennig tries to get the head scissors on. However, Bockwinkel able to maintain his hold, Hennig unable to get his, at least for the moment.
Now, you mentioned, Rod, at the beginning of the match, when we were running down the statistics, the stats on these two men, and you said age. We're talking about the youngest of these two world-class wrestlers is, of course, Curt Hennig. He's the youngest, and we always remember that old English expression, youth, that priceless asset. Will it be a priceless asset for Curt Hennig tonight? Or if you're watching it in Hawaii, you're watching it in the afternoon, as the time zones change when these pictures are shown all over the world in various time zones.
Again, the side headlock, which he has maintained for several minutes. Nick Bockwinkel, the champion. Curt Hennig, the challenger, shakes it off, takes a hard shoulder block, and then he comes up with a knee and catches Bockwinkel on the way in. That took the wind away from the champion. However, he kicks out very quickly, picks up Curt Hennig, body slam, kick out by Hennig. We are seeing it all, body slam by Hennig on the champion. Arm drag takedown, Curt Hennig. Again the arm drag, and an arm bar here on the champion.
Boy, the fans are really getting into this match. We're not up to the 10-minute mark, and they've been top speed for the first 8 or 9 minutes.
10 minutes. All around the world, it's for the heavyweight championship of the world. There's the challenger, Curt Hennig. There's the champion, Nick Bockwinkel. Hennig in control on the offensive at this point in this match. But from that standpoint of who has had the better of it offensively so far, that would have to go to the champion, Nick Bockwinkel, which is really not surprising in that he is the veteran that he is. And he opened up with a surprise, a drop kick into the middle of Curt Hennig's back after the handshake in the center of the ring. And that's when the match is underway. And Hennig turned his back to walk back to the corner, and Bockwinkel caught him. And he maintained that dominance and pressure at least up to this point in time. Time will tell.
Excuse me, Rodham. I was going to say about 4 years ago, if this match had happened, I think Bockwinkel would have won the match in the first 4 or 5 seconds. But his opponent has got a lot more moxie right now. He is a veteran himself. He is in the top physical condition and the peak of his career. Watch this, crisscross, up and over. Whoa!
Another quick arm drag by Curt Hennig, and he goes to the arm bar on the champion, using the knee to the side of the head, the side of Nick Bockwinkel's head. Nick Bockwinkel out of Beverly Hills, California, born in St. Louis, Missouri. He has held the Pacific Coast title, the U.S. Heavyweight Championship 3 times, the Western Tag Team title with Ray the Crippler Stevens, the Hawaiian Tag Team Championship, the California State title, the Hawaiian Ring Gold Belt. He and Stevens held the World Tag Team title for 3 years, losing it in July of 1974. They won it back in October of 74 from the Crusher and Billy Robinson in Winnipeg. And it was at age 16 that Nick Bockwinkel had his very first match against then world champion Lou Fez, a name that I'm sure is very, very familiar to you.
Right, and I was there in Crystal Beach, Ontario, Canada, 16 years old. Bockwinkel was wrestling. Of course, he was older for his age, like I was. You grow up very quick when you get hammered around in life or when you're early. So, oh, beautiful move by Hennig, who learned that from his dad. I know he did.
Leg drop here by Hennig on the arm of Bockwinkel, and Hennig goes back to the arm bar. Bockwinkel, you see a close-up of him there, grabbed a hold of Kurt's hair and somersaulted him, but Kurt did not let go of the hold. The tenacity of two tremendous grapplers here in the AWA for the championship of the world on the Major League of Professional Wrestling from the Showboat Sports Pavilion in Las Vegas, Nevada. Rod Trongard, along with Lord James Blears, glad to bring it your way.
Rod, it should we dissect the bodies right now. Bockwinkel has a longer body and shorter legs. His opponent, Curt Hennig, has longer legs and a shorter body. And that will mean that this match is going to be nip and tuck, because they will apply a different series of holds when they can, because of the leverage, because of the low center of gravity that lower center of gravity that Bockwinkel has. So Curt Hennig must offset this with cunningness, with maneuverability, and with his energy.
Oh. A hammerlock by Curt Hennig, trying to move it up into a chicken wing. And you saw him use his leg and body for additional pressure on the left arm of Bockwinkel just seconds ago.
Well, what he's trying to do now is shagging the arm. As we say, he's hooking it in an amateur move now. He's pulling
him
over.
You saw Bockwinkel's left shoulder come up off the mat. and just in time. Tremendous bridge here by Bockwinkel. Has to be tremendous strength in a wrestler's neck to make this happen.
Well, he kicks out of that one, and Bockwinkel is not happy, but he's a lot happier than the position that he was being maneuvered into. There are no points in professional wrestling. When you have points in amateur wrestling, I'd say Rod Trungard was right. Bockwinkel would be a couple of points ahead, but there are no points, so it's academic. And it's just you pin him in or you pin him or make him submit.
There's a term in amateur wrestling that could come into play here over the past few minutes as a series of elbow smashes breaks the hold of Curt Hennig. Uh-oh, Bockwinkel going for a shoulder block, and Hennig gets out of the way, and Bockwinkel crashed into that post. The term I was thinking about, and Hennig had it there for a few minutes, was riding time.
That's right.
See in high school and collegiate wrestling.
Absolutely.
Up, twisting that arm, and Bockwinkel will head the somersault and go with it, or there could have been very serious damage to the left arm if there hasn't been already.
Well, Bockwinkel will hit that steel post. We saw that happen just the other day, but it does happen a lot. Seizing the opportunity, Curt Hennig is now applying pressure on the left arm of world heavyweight champ Nick Bockwinkel.
You saw the wrist, and now he goes into that bar again. He was also using his knee as a fulcrum on the left elbow of Nick Bockwinkel. Very, very, extremely painful. A tremendous match here, ladies and gentlemen, for the AWA Heavyweight Championship of the World. Nick Bockwinkel at 247 pounds, and Curt Hennig, who took a blow there at 248, and Bockwinkel is back in control, at least for the moment. Hard body slam on the young man out of Robbinsdale, Minnesota. Again, Bockwinkel. Again, the body slam on Curt Hennig. A kick out that caught Bockwinkel right in the face. An arm drag and a takedown here by Curt Hennig, who shakes the head and shakes out the cobwebs.
Boy, he just got out of that one in time. I was ready for another follow-up on that. I can't tell you now what he was going to do. But Curt Hennig's in the driver's seat now. Pouring on the pressure. He's staying with that left arm that he hopes was injured when Bockwinkel hit the steel post. We'll find out in a couple of minutes whether or not he keeps going after the arm. If he doesn't think he can win after that arm, he'll go someplace else. But right now he's working on the arm.
I know I have not seen a match like this. As you get a close-up of Curt, I have not seen a match like this in a long, long time. Usually you have the contrasting styles of, well, such as the midnight rockers and the playboy and the pretty boy, and they hammer and they club away and they'll use anything and everything at their disposal. The Sheik Adnan LKC type. Here you have, and although both are big and rough and tough and able to pound away and beat up and beat on each other, you have two men who are wrestling within the rules. And the thousands here at the Showboat Sports Pavilion in Las Vegas and the millions more watching worldwide are enjoying every second of it.
They sure are. That's a short arm scissor. There's a two count on Hennig. Flipped his man over. He's got the leg scissored with his own arm as leverage on the left arm, the so-called injured arm. We don't know it's injured. We're only just assuming it. But it might be a little weaker now than it was before.
Certainly, because it's been worked on, and worked on rather devastatingly over the past few minutes. But now a somersault, and for a moment or two, Curt Hennig was precariously close to a pinfall.
A lot of times, Rod, and wrestling fans, you have to let that out when you get tipped over backwards and a man cinches you up. You've got to just get rid of the hold and get out of there, because you can be in trouble. You can lose a match with a simple maneuver like that. Holding on tight. And also, this does not just hurt the arm. It cuffs up the blood supply to the wrist. And when the fingers start going white, that's when you've got a good chance of winning with a submission.
And those fingers look pretty white from here.
What a shot. Beautiful camera work. Pretty as a picture. Only two men not enjoying this. Buckwinkle and Henning. They're enjoying it as professionals. And I'm enjoying it as an announcer. I know you are, Rod.
Absolutely.
But I meant it in a different vein.
This is an awesome, awesome match between two tremendous wrestlers. And now, suddenly, Buckwinkle has Curt Hennig in a leg spread. Tremendous, tremendous pressure and pain here.
Well, if you never had a hernia, that's how you get one. Believe me. Spinning the toe, twisting the inside of the leg. It gets your knee, gets your ankle, and it gets the big, heavy thigh bone. And in the stomach muscles. If you're not hard there, you'll be in the hospital.
Several years ago, one of the first opportunities that I had to talk with Vern Gagne, he told me that one of the greatest qualities that a wrestler must have is a very high pain threshold. And here we are seeing Curt Hennig and Nick Buckwinkle, two men with extremely high pain thresholds. They have put each other through extremely painful wrestling holds. Buckwinkle maintaining control and the hold on Curt Hennig.
Holding on to the hold, as Rod just explained to you. Buckwinkle's trying to hook the arm, too. Now then, he'll roll his man up. He changed his mind. He was ready to get hooked. It's cat and mouse all the time. Buckwinkle reaches back with his left arm. He's going to get it hooked, even though he has his opponent in a real bad position. A double toe hold, face down on the mat.
Two very, very courageous, durable, well-conditioned, powerful men going at each other with everything that they have for the heavyweight championship of the world. And over the past several months, over the past 2-3 years, I have come to know both of these men. I have done telecasts with Nick Buckwinkle as my color announcer. I have come to know Curt Hennig, his father Larry the Axe Hennig. It's going to be difficult to see one of these two lose this match, if indeed that would be the case. The way things are going now, we well could be here for a 60-minute duration, which could then end up in a draw. Nick Buckwinkle working over Curt Hennig with a series of forearm smashes to the midsection, and then a snapmare, and flat on his back is the young man out of Robbinsdale, Minnesota.
Well, an hour's a long time, and I think this might finish up before then. What we were talking about that Rod said before was that you get to know these wrestlers, and sometimes you might want to talk, or think you may want to talk a little bit about your favorite. But the mark of a good referee, a good announcer, is that you remain neutral at all times. Rod Trungard is one of the most neutral men in his announcing that I've ever had the pleasure of sitting in with. And the referee is doing a heck of a job out there, because he is a professional, and he doesn't care who wins, just as long as it's done the right way. So that's what wrestling is all about.
Both of these men, I am sure, have prepared themselves in the absolute best way that they know how, in talking with others, other wrestlers. Curt Hennig, of course, I'm sure, talking with his father a lot, with Vern Gagne, with Greg Gagne. Nick Buckwinkle, I'm sure, maybe has talked to some of the same people. They have prepared themselves extremely well. The look of power and strength and grits and what have you. Uh-oh, Buckwinkle is now grabbing a hold of the trunk of Curt Hennig. Almost got a pinfall there.
Boy, that was the first illegal move since the beginning of the match. Buckwinkle grabbed a handful of tights, dived out of the ring, and he Wisely's taking a rest. Could this now, Rod, could this mean that Bockwinkel is losing his wind a little bit, maybe? Or what do you think?
It does look like he may be tiring more than just a bit, buying some time outside of the ring, now getting back in. As we said at the outset, of course, he has the experience on his side. Kurt Hennig has the youth on his. Both men in extremely excellent condition. But it may just be that the champion may tire a bit more quickly, than Kurt Hennig. And now, it is for some reason or another, Bockwinkel pointing at Kurt Hennig, pointing to the floor of the ring. For what? I do not know. Let us watch and see what happens as you get a close-up there of the challenger. And now of the two of them.
I'm sorry, Ron. I was going to say, what he wants to do, I think he wants to get him down on the mat. And he said, when I get you down, but he didn't get him.
Side headlock here by Hennig. Bockwinkel wraps both arms around, pushes his man off. Hard shoulder block by Hennig.
This is what he did. He got him down, a drop toe hold. Enrique Torres, a world champion in his day, retired now up in the ski country, used that devastating effect.
And it happened so quickly.
Oh, boy, you could roll a man up and pop his knee.
Talk about timing.
Timing was perfect.
It has to be.
And you've got two great men in there. When they've wrestled such as men like Harley Race, Dory Funk Jr., Terry Funk, Hulk Hogan, Tenaru, Rick Martel, Ric Flair, you know all these names. They're all famous names and all great wrestlers. Vern Gagne. There's a 1,000. Nay, 2,000. We couldn't possibly tell you all of the top men in professional wrestling in the past 25 years.
Timing, durability, quickness, strength, knowledge of holds, moves, and counter moves, it all adds up to talent. And both of these men have it in spades, and it is Kurt Hennig in deep pain as you heard him scream out as Nick Bockwinkel applied the pressure and that hold. He has the left leg of Kurt Hennig all wrapped up and grinding away. That ankle is paying the price. The knee is paying the price. The quadricep muscles are paying the price. The back is paying the price, all of Kurt Hennig at this very moment.
And the referee's hanging in there, because if Kurt Hennig cries uncle and he says, that's it, ref, he's got me, I can't take it anymore, Bockwinkel would win the match. Let me tell you one thing, ladies and gentlemen. There are two different tacticians out there. Number one, Bockwinkel is the champion. The champion has an advantage in as much as he does not have to win the match. All Bockwinkel has to do is have the time run out or win the match. Two options. The challenger must go after the champion. He must win the match with a distinct fall or a submission to win the belt. So the champion, and he earns the right, has the advantage of playing a different type of a game. He can stall a bit. He can hang back a little bit. He doesn't have to attack as much. The challenger must always go forward and, as they say in French, j'attaque.
Kurt Hennig grabbing a hold of Nick Bockwinkel's hair and powering and pounding away on the champion. Some other qualities that both of these men have, cunning and guile, both very, very necessary to win, to persevere, to stay on top in the game, and of course, a word that really need not be mentioned at all, and the word is courage. Both of them have it, unquestionably, as Kurt Hennig, now limping a bit, on that left leg, comes down,
whoa,
a knee drop onto the arm, onto the tricep of the champion, the left leg of Kurt Hennig in a lot of pain, and Bockwinkel knows it and drops on it, turns it into a figure four, into an Indian deathlock.
And this could be a lot of trouble for Kurt Hennig. Remember, ladies and gentlemen, it's not how many times you get knocked down, it's how many times you get up that counts. That's the important thing in a true athlete. And all you youngsters, remember that. Remember it. Don't ever give up. Never give up. Not just in sports, but in anything you do.
Hard forearm smashes by both men as Curt Hennig is looking for a way, reaching back for a way to somehow or another get the champion to break this death-like vice grip that he has, the Indian deathlock. And as this match goes on, the longer it goes on, 30 minutes have gone by. You have the stamina and the resiliency of these two men that will more and more come into play.
Oh, you're absolutely 1,000% right. These men have got the hearts of lions. They're lions out there. And Buckwinkle heads for the ropes. The crowd kind of booed a little bit, but the crowd, let me tell you, ladies and gentlemen, they're sitting on the edge of their seats. There's not one person in this arena moved since the beginning of this match. Buckwinkle is now using a lot of... I didn't think he'd start doing that right now because he was still wrestling even with his opponent.
But it may be the fact that after 30 minutes, he might feel it slipping away a bit, and he may feel that he has to resort to whatever tactic is necessary to win. He fired three hard knees to the midsection of Curt Hennig before popping him out of the ring and now watching him very, very closely. And Curt's going to have to get himself back in before the 10 count of Gary DeRusha. And let me say a word about the job that Gary DeRusha has done. And he is soaking wet. He is working in his own way as hard as the wrestlers are. He is very, very much aware of the importance of the job that he has to do in this match for the championship of the world. He's doing it, and he's doing it in great style. And now the sleeper hold.
Oh.
The Nick Buckwinkle sleeper hold on Curt Hennig. We knew it would be coming. We haven't seen the axe yet from Curt Hennig. We had not seen the sleeper hold. And now Buckwinkle reverses it on Curt Hennig.
He's got to get to that middle rope. He's trying to reach and get the rope, pull himself out. He could be going out. You can see his eyes turning. You can see the eyes getting glazed.
Look at that.
The carotid artery cuts off the blood supply to the brain. He gets that rope. Oh!
And as we were talking about Gary DeRusha, all of them are out of the ring on the floor directly in front of us. DeRusha took a tremendous shot to the midsection, may have cracked some ribs, and then he cracked his head on the way down to the floor, and maybe cracked his head on the cement floor, as both Nick Buckwinkle and Curt Hennig are on the floor in front of us. And it could well be a 10 count on both of them outside the ring, but who is there to count?
That's right, I was just going to say that. This is a break for both of them. We'll never know. Right now, they're fighting.
It is Buckwinkle getting his head bounced off the apron of the ring. Gary DeRusha rolling over, trying to get back in it. As you see him in the lower part of your screen, and the battle going on behind him between Curt Hennig and Nick Buckwinkle. And it is Hennig back into the ring first, dragging Buckwinkle back in. And Gary DeRusha, slowly but surely, dragging himself to his feet.
Rope. Oh, he's in, okay.
A cover here, Curt Hennig on Buckwinkle.
Oh.
A count of two, as DeRusha instinctively saw what was happening. Not having seen how it happened, he immediately began the count. Staggers back into the ropes. I believe he has got it back. Curt Hennig has. Buckwinkle may not have. Buckwinkle and DeRusha are both in a very bad way at this point in time in this match. It is Curt Hennig outside of the ring. Is he going to wrap the arm around the post?
He sure
is.
Here
it comes.
Tally ho, and he did it. You know, you hit the nail on the head, Rod, when you said when he made the announcement, the timekeeper ringside, 30 minutes. Buckwinkle could have suddenly realized, hey, wait a minute, this is going too long. And he tried to wrap it up.
I don't believe he has been in a match of this duration since I have known him or seen him. I have not seen all of his matches, but I do not know of one, I do not know of any that I have seen that have gone this long. But he is the champion, and the champions reach back for that little something extra, as you saw right there. His cunning and guile coming into play, instinctively coming up with a boot into the face of Curt Hennig.
Well, I'm happy to see the referees moving around now. Otherwise, we would have had to get another referee because he was out like a light. In fact, I was going to have a young lady throw some ice water on Jerusha, but he seems to be okay now.
Step over toe hold here by Bakrenkov. Curt Hennig grabs the hair and pulls him off.
Curt Hennig has got the cobwebs moved out of his brain now, but he's still limping on his left leg. This reminds me of a match that Vern Gagne had with the famous Lou Thesz many, many years ago. A match very similar with short arm scissors and all these various moves that you've seen in the last 35 minutes.
Oh, hey! It looked like it was all over, but at the last possible instant, Curt Hennig kicked his way out. At the last possible instant.
Here's the whip.
The slingshot across. Hennig ducks under. Hennig, he comes across with a flying body press. Oh, and again a two count.
Well, there's a lot of men up in heaven looking down now who were yesteryear's great champions. Ed Strangler Lewis, Frank Gotch, Yvonne Robert, Ed Dunn, George. And some of them who were here to, another one, Vincent Lopez, and then ones who are still with us, Enrique Torres, Mad Dog Vachon, Pat O'Connor.
How about Argentina Antonino Rocca?
Oh, he's gone, but he was watching from above as the wrestlers watch one of the greatest matches that I've had the pleasure of sitting at ringside and narrating, along with Rod Trongard. I know we're both going to need throat lozenges for the next couple of weeks, but it's worth it, Rob.
But what we will need is nothing
to what they'll need.
But then again, you have to remember that they are conditioned to do what they are, and you and I are supposed to be conditioned to do what we are doing. But everybody is paying a price here, including the referee, who has paid a dear price. Bockwinkel bounces the head of Curt Hennig off of the steps on the far side of the ring, and although they are carpeted and somewhat padded, there is hardwood underneath, and no give to it whatsoever. A close-up of Curt Hennig.
Both men tried for the first 30 minutes to wrestle each other, to feel each other out. There was a couple of times when one leg was injured, an arm was hurting, but then they started getting into pounding a little bit. Outside the ring, three men were knocked out. How long, how much? 37.
Larry Nelson making the announcement. However, one thing maybe you did not see, I was watching Bockwinkel as he came across the ring. He asked Larry Nelson, how much time left?
Uh-huh.
How much time left? Indicative of the fact he may well be running out of gas.
The champion's in trouble, ladies and gentlemen, when you ask the timekeeper. Oh, wait a minute.
Uh-oh. Here it comes. Oh! That could pop a cartilage, tear a ligament. And the champion is in tremendous pain. Tremendous pain. And Curt Hennig is outside of the ring. He's going to have to get back in very quickly, or else be disqualified as the count reaches 6-7.
Whoa.
Just in time. Curt Hennig back inside that ring. And Nick Bockwinkel feeling the pain in the left leg, the knee, the thigh, the hamstring. Curt Hennig limping noticeably in the ring. Gary Jerusha as well.
I was going to say, Rod, all the young ladies now, all the pretty ones are all standing up and waving. They want their hero to become the new World Heavyweight Wrestling Champion.
And I believe it's almost 50-50 in this crowd as to who they are for. Yes, you mentioned the young ladies, and of course they would be looking in the direction of Curt Hennig. The other wrestling fans, and I would guess some of the young ladies as well, be looking into the direction of Nick Bockwinkel, the champion. They are seeing the best of the best.
Oh, I love that. That's it. You said it all. The best of the best.
The AWA home of professional wrestling's very, very best. The Major League, the greatest champions in the world, where only the biggest, the most agile, the leanest, the meanest, the roughest, the toughest, the most scientific, the quickest, the fastest, and the strongest make it. The American Wrestling Association, and we're seeing it all here in Nick Bockwinkel and Curt Hennig.
Well, if this match were to end right now, it would go down in the history of the past 5 or 7 years as one of the greatest matches that I've seen, and anyone. I'm telling you now.
Reversal!
You know it.
Count of two. Curt Hennig.
2.5.
Yes, indeed. Curt Hennig again to the cover on the champion. Again, a two count. And to the credit of Gary DeRusha, who is hanging in there as gamely as these two wrestlers. Gary took a tremendous shot in the ribs and then came out of the ring and crashed headfirst onto the cement floor. And now a knee lift by Bockwinkel. And it is Hennig who is cartwheeled over. Bockwinkel on his hands and knees. Hennig grabbing a hold of the solar plexus, trying to get it back. Bockwinkel coming over, grabbing a hold of the hair. Bockwinkel going for the pile driver. Bockwinkel picking up Hennig. Here it is.
Oh, he got it. Wait a minute.
Did he ever?
This could be it, folks. This might be it. Bockwinkel's on his man. One, a two.
No three because the right leg of Curt Hennig is draped over that top rope strand. And that is the only thing that saved him.
That was the other referee. The other referee was the camera lens. Because I didn't see it from here. And then Rod spotted the big white shoe. Lucky we have a camera. Lucky to have a white shoe. And lucky the several people saw that, because the leg was out. It was a no count, but he was flat.
Again, a toe hold here. Nick Bockwinkel asks the referee to ask Curt Hennig if he wants to submit. He knows he has Hennig in a bad, bad way. Hennig may be close. Hennig may be close to letting go. No, 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 he says as he shakes his head, taking tremendous, almost unbearable pain.
Look at the help he's used. Bockwinkel pushing the rope for leverage. That's an illegal move. The referee is so intent on the count, he should look as the champion, using every little bit of the wrong tactics, the illegal moves, the little shady ones. That's the one the champion uses, ones that no one sees, or the referee does it when the referee's not there, or whatever.
Headbutt there by Curt Hennig. The hold is broken. We now see the stamina, the durability, the resiliency, all of those things coming into play here. Curt Hennig was in a tremendously bad way and going to work with the boots now on the champion, driving the boot one time, twice, five times into the midsection, and now dropping his 247 pounds on the back of the champion. Curt Hennig continuing with the surfboard on the champion, Nick Bockwinkel. Hennig sitting on Bockwinkel, as you see, and what you don't see, he had his hand cupped around the chin of Bockwinkel and pulling his head backwards as he was putting his 247 pounds in a reverse direction. Now what does he have in mind? Curt Hennig onto the hamstrings of Nick Bockwinkel, particularly the left leg, and a leg drop by Curt Hennig.
And that was legal. It was high up. It was high up enough to not be disqualified.
Both of these men have given everything they have, and then some. And it's a tribute to their dedication, their conditioning, their... well, golly, I'm almost at a loss for words. Their respect of the sport, the respect of what the championship means. You don't go into a championship match not prepared, physically and mentally, to do 150%.
That's right, Rod, and right now they're reaching down into the depths of their pockets to try and find another maneuver. that could win them this match. They do not want to run that clock out, particularly Kurt Hennig. He has to go ahead and win it.
First one man pounds away, and then the other does. Just when it looks like one is about to put the other away, they, as Colonel De Beers, I beg your pardon, Lord James Blears, I knew I was going to say that. Look at this. As pointed out, they reach back for that something extra. Now you have Kurt Hennig trying to get the champion, the Boston Crab.
At this stage of the game, if he could turn him over and send Jeff the Crab, Bockwinkel, I would say, would be too weak a condition to get out of it unless he can reach the rope. He's within a couple of feet of that bottom red strand. Bockwinkel can reach that rope. 15 minutes left. Bockwinkel cannot stay in this hole for 15 minutes. I guarantee you that.
I don't know that Kurt Hennig can hold it for 15 minutes, but look at the face, the painful expression on the face of Nick Bockwinkel as Kurt Hennig, with every ounce of strength at his command, tries to put him away.
Kurt Hennig could rear his head back now and throw the head back. If he could, he's trying. If he could do that, he'll win this match with a submission. Oh. The champion is there. He's going to do one of his hard push-ups. He does 1,000 of those a day, and that's where it pays off.
What incredible guts and courage and strength is shown here, and a two count. A quick reversal by Kurt Hennig, but here you have the champion with his legs draped over the rope strands.
The fans are sitting on the edge of the seats, ladies and gentlemen. It's sort of an unbelievable sight here at the Showboat in Las Vegas as the people jammed in here watching two of the greatest wrestlers of all time battling it out. You don't see this very often. You're seeing it all around throughout the world in various time zones. You're watching it by the invention of television.
Oh, what a shot by Kurt Hennig. Three hard shoulder smashes to the midsection. Now judo shots to the throat. Judo, karate, you name it, a small package. He may have the belt. Somehow, again, Bockwinkel gets out.
The referee got hit again. He's limping on his left leg now.
And now we may have the pile driver from Kurt Hennig on Nick Bockwinkel. He picks him up. There it is. Hennig turning over.
He's near the rope.
On the cover. Again, it is the ropes that come into play. Men using everything they can possibly think of in this match.
You know, Rod, the timekeeper, the Wahine, or the young lady sitting with the bell over there, Hashida, as excited as anybody. I'm just afraid she might hit that bell at the wrong time, but I'm sure she won't.
She's keeping her eye on the clock. Kurt Hennig. Behind him, Nick Bockwinkel. Gary DeRussia in the count at four. Both men to their feet. Well, one at least, as the count is stopped at five.
There's a little Greco-Roman wrestling going on there now.
Side headlock, Kurt Hennig. Picked up by Bockwinkel. Down both of men go. Both men were hurt on that. It was Bockwinkel trying to put the suplex on Kurt Hennig, but he took as much of it as Hennig did. But it's Bockwinkel turning over first, and a cover and a count of one and two. And again, it is the leg over the bottom rope strand that saved Kurt Hennig this time.
And you notice, Rod, and wrestling fans, these two men now, although they've got a lot of cobwebs, he thought he won.
Look at this. A reversal, a rollover, and a count.
Oh, I thought that was it.
This is too much. It is too much.
Bockwinkel doesn't know where he is. Now he knows where he is. He's flat on his back in the middle of the ring at the Showboat.
Taking elbow smash after elbow smash after elbow smash from Kurt Hennig. Covers him, hooks the leg, but again gets only the two count.
Well, the champ has been there before, and he's going to be there again. He kicked his man out, just got out in time.
Ooh.
They're going just on guts alone right now.
Knee into the middle of the back of the champion. Kurt Hennig, boots to the head.
Kurt seems to be shaking off that injury to his right leg. He was limping, I believe, on his right leg this time. But he's seems to have shaken it off.
There's the whip. Bockwinkel staggering around, takes a tremendously hard right hand. Back comes Curt Hennig with a karate shot. Oh. A drop kick caught Bockwinkel flush. Curt Hennig now sensing he may have the belt at his command, drags the champion to the center, hooks the leg, and again a two count. Where do they find it? Where do they find the strength, the resiliency to come back time after time after time? Uh-oh, a shot into the throat. A judo shot to the throat of Curt Hennig. Here's a count of two.
And the right shoulder just rolling out. Curt Hennig just bricks just in time.
Has gone by. Only 10 minutes remain.
You heard it, wrestling fans all around the world. They're two of the greatest wrestlers.
Uh-oh. Abdominal stretch. Nick Bockwinkel has it.
And he's clamped down. He's got to hook that foot around. He has to hook the boot around the back of the calf on the left leg. But they're into the ropes. Curt Hennig is wise. Bockwinkel is veteran and wise.
You just wonder. Oh, my. A knee to the solar plexus. And you saw Curt Hennig cartwheel to the center of the ring.
I believe that Bockwinkel was playing, as you Americans say, playing possum for a moment. It looked like it because he suddenly came to life.
Again, the cover. Again, the cover after another knee to the midsection of Curt Hennig. Some way, somehow, from somewhere, they reach back into their tank of strength. And now it is a double leg pickup here by Curt Hennig, a step over, toe hold. Uh-oh, Bockwinkel kicks Hennig off and kicked him right into the ring post. Hennig, face first on the cement floor in front of us, as you saw. Nick Bockwinkel, as you see, getting to his feet. Coming, or is he coming to the outside of the ring? Greg Gagne has moved in alongside of us to watch this with the millions and millions of wrestling fans across the world who are looking on. Greg's father, Vern, has gone the distance on many, many occasions. And now you have Curt Hennig, who is bleeding. Drops of blood have fallen to the floor. And you saw a quick look there, and you'll see another one here very, very shortly. There it is. As you see, his forehead is split open.
You know, I thought it was blood coming out of his mouth, that he spit blood out of his mouth, but his forehead is gashed as he hit that post on the way out, probably hit the turnbuckle that fits on the edge of the post. The count is on.
Curt Hennig outside that ring as the count reaches two inside, and it stops, of course, every time the man who is inside of the ring comes over, and in this instance, it is Nick Bockwinkel.
Bockwinkel's going to try and finish him off now. This is his only opportunity.
It may be his last opportunity. But credit Nick Bockwinkel with tremendous conditioning. Oh, he bounces the head of Curt Hennig again off that ring apron. And how Curt Hennig stays with it, I do not know. Look at the glazed eyes. And here again is Bockwinkel, sensing he has the match under control. He needs to get Curt Hennig back into the ring.
Bockwinkel's named the man of 1,000 holes, and he's used about 989 of them right now. He'd better start looking for a couple more.
Up over the turnbuckle, and again into that ring post, the head of Curt Hennig, and we'll get another close-up. Look at that. Oh!
7 minutes
You heard it.
Unbelievable! A hard right hand, a fist to the forehead. Curt Hennig bleeding profusely, which is as mild as I can put it. He is flat on his back. The champion coming over, covering the challenger. The count is one.
Oh.
It is two. It looked like it was all over, but it is not.
I'll tell you what, Rod. Wrestling fans, if this was an ordinary match, the referee stopped the match. The blood flowing, but the referees are ordered by the championship committee
The referee.
In a championship match, Greg, as you know, in a championship match, the referee
is
cautioned to allow it to go on as long as he possibly can.
Kurt Hennig is being checked now by the referee, and he fires away. Kurt Hennig's face, a maze of blood. Kurt Hennig with the axe. The axe by Kurt Hennig. Has he done it?
Again, he
hammers away. Bockwinkel is just about out on his feet. Again, the axe by Kurt Hennig. Is the championship about to change hands?
The referee's checking him to see if he should stop the match.
The blood is spurting from his forehead. It is running down his face onto Nick Bockwinkel. And still the match goes on.
I think Bockwinkel's bleeding now. Wait a minute.
There's blood all over Bockwinkel.
Bockwinkel was opened up with the axe.
This is as brutal as I have seen.
They're hammering each other now, ladies and gentlemen. In the corner, it's Kurt Hennig. The champion is trying to hold this man off now. Kurt Hennig must win this match. He cannot allow it to go the time limit.
Must win it if he is going to claim the championship belt. Another axe by Kurt Hennig. He staggers backwards as Nick Bockwinkel is split wide open as well. Here is a cover on the champion. No, it is not even a count that has begun because Bockwinkel has his arm draped over that lower rope strand. Kurt Hennig pulls him back in, picks him. I thought he was going to pile drive him. He twisted the head. Now a back heel kick to the head of Bockwinkel as we're into the final 4 minutes.
Well, they've been wrestling 55 minutes, believe it or not, or 54 minutes, ladies and gentlemen, in one of the greatest matches. Watching it. It's not over. The fans are going wild here at the Showboat.
Kurt Hennig, here's a whip. A whip on Bockwinkel. Again, the axe. Four times Kurt Hennig has gone to the axe. How in the world can Bockwinkel sustain? Bockwinkel is flat on his face. Kurt Hennig has got to roll him over and get him on his back in order to get the pinfall.
And one of the wrestlers has a tooth knocked out. We just learned that from Larry Nelson. Who was it? There's a tooth flew out of one of the wrestlers' mouth. That gives you an idea of the intensity. 53 minutes have gone.
All you have to do is look at the two wrestlers. Just look at them, and you know the intensity and the violence of this match, this championship match. Kurt Hennig for the AWA Championship of the World. The champion is Nick Bockwinkel. I doubt that he has ever been in one like it in his championship life. As Kurt Hennig breaks the laces of the boots across the forehead, front face lock, picking him up for a suplex. How he is able to do it.
This could be it.
Bockwinkel.
Turnover. Come on. Over.
And Kurt Hennig get up and over.
He did it. He is on top.
He did it. A count of two. He may have gotten three had he been able to get there earlier. He was unable to do so. We're nearing the final 2 minutes of this match. Nearing the 58-minute mark.
This is unbelievable, ladies and gentlemen.
I don't know that I've got 2 minutes left.
2 minutes remaining.
Kurt Hennig is the strongest man right now. He must win this match. Bockwinkel has got to stall and do anything.
Elbow smash.
He doesn't know where he is.
Elbow smash. Cover. Count. Again, the count goes only to two.
And at one part of this match, Bockwinkel covered, or Hennig covered Bockwinkel, or whoever it was, when the face was down and the back was up.
Step over, toe hold. Going into the figure four, the Indian deathlock. This may be submission time. Bockwinkel is the man in all of the pain. But time is running out on both of them, on both Bockwinkel and on Kurt Hennig.
I think it would have to be a pinfall to end this match. These men are so immune from pain right now for 60 minutes practically.
They have to be literally numb with little if any feeling remaining. We're in the final minute. We are in the final minute. I will never forget it as long as I live, however this ends, with less than 60 seconds remaining, these two men have given everything that there is to give. Not only that they have to give, but there is to give to the sport of professional wrestling. They have pounded, they have hammered, they have clawed, they have dug, they have put on every hold that they know, every weapon at their command, as we're in the final 30 seconds of this match.
And listen to the crowd. Sit down, Greg. Grab a hold of Greg Gagne. You could jump up there. Staybach, he's so excited. Buckwinkle hanging on to the referee.
Oh.
He's telling 15. Shaking. He's shaking it up.
Buckwinkle. Can he hang on for another 15 here at the Showboat Sports Pavilion? Coast to coast, continent to continent. The count is going down to one. It is all over. It is all over. Kurt Hennig and Nick Buckwinkle have gone, and Lord James Blairs did not think it would happen the full 60 minutes. It is a draw. It is a draw. But Kurt Hennig thinks he has won the match.
Time ran out.
Time ran out. Kurt Hennig's hand was raised. Nick Bockwinkel's hand all the way also raised. There you see Kurt as he is shocked. He is shocked by it. He thought that he had the championship. He thought he had it. He came so very, very close. How much closer can you possibly come without winning it? I don't know. Lord James Blairs, Greg Gagne, I am totally, totally spent. Oh, what a match. What a championship match.
Rod.
Lord James Blairs, go ahead.
Okay, Rod. Well, you see the champion. All he had to do was hang on for 1 hour. He didn't hang on. He went and took the match to his opponent right from the word go, kept battling away, and then the match settled down, then it sparked up again. The match is a draw, as you heard. Time ran out. It was 1 hour, one full hour, and Rod Trungard's voice is gone with mine. But Rod, I think that was one of the finest exhibitions of tenacity and courage that you'll ever see in a football field, a baseball field, in a wrestling ring, anywhere, boxing, you name it.
Absolutely. Beyond a shadow of a doubt. It would have been an injustice for the championship to change hands here, and this is nothing against Kurt Hennig.
You understand? I'm just getting my breath. You understand me? Bockwinkle, you're mine. I know it now.